Hindustani music today includes a strong presence of a variety of instruments in solo performances. That is, we have the sitar, sarood, bansuri or flute, santoor, all of these that are quite prominent on the scene. Now, a variety of musical instruments are discussed in music texts through the centuries. You can also see them in sculptures, paintings, and descriptions are found in literary works too. The Natya Shastra offers a very interesting and quite viable classification of instruments based on the principle of how sound is produced. And nearly 2 millennia later, Zax and Hornbostel, they came up with a system that is now globally followed, which follows the same idea, the same principle of classification. So, what are the various ways in which musical instruments make sound? That is, all sound is vibration. So, we could have music that is made by a vibrating string. This is called, this class of instruments is called Tatavadya in the Natya Shastra. And these include both plucked string instruments and bowed string instruments. So, you have sitar, sarod, which are plucked, right? The guitar also is a plucked instrument, whereas violin, sarangi, these are bowed. There are other instruments like the bean, surbahar, surshrungar, these are very rarely performed today. The second class of instruments is Sushiravadya, where we have a vibrating column of air. So, you have the flute, obviously the shehnai, even the harmonium, which we have seen earlier. The third class of instruments is called Avanadha, a membrane of phone is under the Zax Hornbostel system. The Shushiravadya are called aerophones. String instruments are the Tatavadya are called chordophones. So, this the third class, third category of instruments is called Avanadha or membranophone, where a membrane is pulled tight over something and that is the vibrating substance, and that is how music is made. So, tabla, pakhavaj, etc. would fall under this category. And then you have a solid surface, which is the vibrating substance, and these are called ghanavadya. Obvious examples are the cymbals, the tala. So, now broadly, in terms of their roles, we can speak of two kinds of instruments, melodic and percussive. Melodic instruments are those on which ragas are performed, while percussive instruments for our purposes are really two, tabla and pakhavaj, which serve as percussive accompaniment. And this lesson is about melodic instruments. Now, instrumental music is regarded as separate genre in Hindustani music because it has its own repertoire and also method of presentation. In Carnatic music, in contrast, we don't have a separate repertoire of compositions or even a presentational model for instrumental music. So, instrumental music has its own standing, so to say, but nevertheless, it does draw from the vocal genres, vocal styles of Drupad and Khayal, and it also draws from vocal music in other ways, and this is acknowledged in the distinction between what is called Tantkari and the Gayaki Ang. Now, Gayaki Ang, and this has been explained earlier, this is modeled on vocal styles, on the way of the voice, trying to bring, to express on the instrument, the to bring the expression of the human voice on an instrument, to bring out those nuances. Whereas tantkari is playing the instrument in such a way that it exploits the possibilities of that instrument. Each instrument has its possibilities. It has its limitations, but there are unique possibilities of each instrument, and tantkari really exploits those. Instrumental music in Hindustani music is a heady mix of these two approaches to music making, and there are famous rivalries over the superiority of the one or the other approach, that is the gayaki and the tantkari. So though instrumental music has its own story, has its own repertoire and way of presenting ragas, it does draw from Dhrupad and Khayal. It also borrows repertoire, especially from Khayal. And in the manner of presenting raga, it draws from the from Khayal and Dhrupad. So, to give an explanation using the schema, here we have A stands for alap. There is an extensive alap. You have B standing for bandish, C for bol laya or laykari. It is only using rhythmic, only performing rhythmic patterns or creating rhythmic patterns using the text of the composition. And you have D, which is other elements of improvisation, such as bol alap, taan, bol taan, sargam, etc. Now, when you have Dhrupad, in Dhrupad, it progresses like this. First, you have a very extensive alap, and you have already seen the kind of alap that they perform in Dhrupad. From that, after that, it progresses to the bandish, the Dhrupad or the dhamar or whatever it is, and then after that, you have bol laya or laykari, that is using the text of the composition, they perform rhythmic variations and rhythmic play. Now, Khayal starts with a very short alap, okay, which I have not indicated here because it is not really an extensive alap. It starts off with a very short introductory alap and then launches into the bandish, after which really the extensive alap follows. Incorporated into the avartans, as we have seen it. And the other elements of improvisation, including bol laya, are also, they are all performed after the bandish. And how they are brought together, as I said, there is considerable freedom and considerable liberty that the performer exercises in how he wants to bring these elements together. Now, instrumental music, it draws from both these structures, in that it first begins with the extensive alap in the Dhrupad model. So, you have the alap Jod Jhala, as it is called, the rhythmic pulsating kind of alap that is also performed in the instrumental music alap. So, the alap of instrumental music is really the alap of Dhrupad, and then it performs the progresses into the bandish, the what is called gat, after which within the avartan the other elements of improvisation, including some alap, these are brought together. Instrumental music, as I said, draws from both the presentational style of Dhrupad and Khayal. But the overall idiom of the music that we hear in instruments like the sitar, sarod, bansuri, shehnai, etc., this is predominantly the Khayal ang or the Khayal voice. ornaments used, the way phrases are constructed and then built upon, these are all derived from the Khayalang. But we can hear the Drupad Angen instruments that are now almost extinct, like the Surbahar or Surshringar, which are the bass counterparts of the sitar and sarod respectively. The Bheen or the Rudra Bheen is a full-fledged Drupad Anga instrument. It belongs to the Drupad tradition. Celebrated Drupad musicians like Zia Muhyiddin Dagar, Ustad Asad Ali Khan, they have been brilliant performers of this instrument in the last century. And today, Bahauddin Dagar of the Dagar family carries on the legacy of Bheen playing. Let us listen to a short clip of Ustad Asad Ali Khan playing Bheen Plus. I thank Karsten Vicker for permission to use this clip. He is himself a musician and plays the Rudra Bheen. Please see the links below in the description box for more music of the Rudra Bheen. The music of the Bheen has a depth and gravitas that is not found easily elsewhere. So the Bheen and the flute, the Bansuri, are perhaps the most ancient among today's instruments heard in classical music. Some instruments that we hear in classical music today found their way from other spaces, instruments such as the santoor. They are folk instruments in origin. Santoor is a Kashmiri folk instrument, and it found a place for itself in Hindustani music because of the artistry and the sheer brilliance of Pandit Shiv Kumar Sharma, who single-handedly brought prestige and acceptance to this instrument in the world of classical music. Let us watch a clip of santoor performance. Thank you. Similarly, the bansuri or flute too, which is, it's an ancient instrument, but it was one musician who propelled it into the classical music arena, and that was Pandit Pannalal Ghosh. Then the flute, typically before before Pandit Ghosh, the flute was a foot long instrument, high pitched, and that wasn't appropriate for creating the serious music of Hindustani music. So Pandit Ghosh created a long flute with a large diameter to be able to produce the mellow and dignified sound of Hindustani music, thereby bringing depth and seriousness to the music. I'm going to play a short clip from a house concert. This will also give you an idea of patronage of music at various levels. Of course, we have classical music concerts in big auditoria, in all kinds of venues, but a closed chamber setting is still the best way to experience Indian classical music. Yeah, big auditoria with stages that are isolated take away the element of interaction with the audience, which is important for this music, because this music unfolds through creating tension and resolving it in every avartan. And when the musician knows that the audience is with her and the audience is getting what she is doing, that makes for inspiration and for inspired music. The Shehnai too has an interesting story. It's primarily a Mangalavadya, that is an instrument that is played on auspicious occasions such as marriages. Ustad Bismillah Khan worked to give it a place in classical music. His sheer artistry and command gave a new visibility to the Shehnai outside wedding halls. Mm-hmm. A unique feature of instrumental music in India is that most musicians customize their instruments. These are not standardized. All instruments are handcrafted. Now, we will take a look at the sarod and the sitar. Then we have guest lecturers taking us through some aspects of these instruments. The sarod and sitar are both string instruments. They are plucked string instruments. As I have said, the other kind of string instruments are bowed, right? Violin, saringi, etc. But both sitar and sarod are plucked string instruments. And as you listen to our guest lecturers, you will appreciate that though both are plucked string instruments, one of them, the sitar, is fretted. There are frets, while the sarod is unfretted. So they present different challenges to produce rag sangeet. How ornaments are played, how the continuity of the music is maintained, all this is navigated in different ways. Dr. Supriya Shah, who is also at the Benaras Hindu University, talks about the sitar. Dr. Shah refers to two kinds of sitar as customized and used by two great musicians of the 20th century, Pandit Ravi Shankar and Ustad Vilayat Khan. Now, these instruments, it's the same sitar, but they differ in size, the number of strings, even the way the strings are tuned. And after Dr. Shah's lecture demonstration, let us also listen to Pandit Suresh Vyas as he talks about the sarod.